If you had the DNA from a long extinct species, could you bring it back to life? That's the premise for a number of science fiction stories, most notably the Jurassic Park franchise. But the big problem here is that DNA preserved in amber for millions of years would be so completely degraded that there's really no way we could use it to clone dinosaurs. There is, however, another source. The direct descendant of some dinosaurs is still here, walking the earth. And as a bonus, they're very tasty. And this guy is trying to see if it's possible to turn chickens back into dinosaurs by reversing the mutations that change them from reptiles into birds.
Yeah, but your scientists were so preoccupied with whether or not they could that they didn't stop to think if they should.
Yes, we should, Jeff Goldblum. Yes, we should. Because it just might allow us to unlock the secrets that have been stored in our own DNA for eons. Ever since mankind discovered evidence of dinosaurs deep in the Earth's past, we've wondered what it would be like to share the Earth with these giant beasts. The answer, by the way, is bad. Really bad. Dinosaurs are big and they might want to eat you and your whole family. T-Rexes are basically just murder machines on legs. But in a way, we do share the Earth with dinosaurs.
Let's think about birds.
Yeah. Birds are actually direct descendants of dinosaurs. And one of the oldest species of bird is the chicken. Remember this guy? This is Arkat. He's a researcher at the Natural History Museum in London with a focus on evolution and genetics.
Oftentimes, by understanding how something is constructed from scratch, how it's put together during development, can be very informative to explain what happened during evolution.
Chickens are an extremely old species of bird. They haven't evolved dramatically since the Cretaceous. That means we can compare their genes to other birds and understand what makes a beak grow. Or compare them to another close relative, the crocodile, and see what makes a snout instead of a beak. How different skull shapes compare from one species to the next is called the morphospace. And by studying it, scientists can get an idea of how species have changed over time.
It's a very useful concept because it allows us to meaningfully compare the changes which occur, for example, during development, as an embryo turns into a juvenile, turns into adults. Or we can compare, let's say, skulls of different species of animals in the same three-dimensional morphospace, and this allows us to understand which parts of the skull changed by how much and in which direction.
And if there's a gap in the fossil record, they can sometimes predict what sort of skull shape would fit into it. When you combine that with an understanding of genetics, you might be able to predict what kind of mutation would cause that change in the morphospace. In short, over time, you could find the genetic changes that caused those giant murder machines to evolve into tiny, delicious chickens. Arkat and his team analyzed the skulls and DNA of a ton of species to get a sense of what genes changed the way the skull developed.
To do this, we specifically focus on the bones which make up the snouts and the beak in birds, and we looked at their shape changes over time, over evolutionary time. And we realized at some point that there is a gap between the part of the morphospace which is occupied by animals with snouts and modern birds, which all have beaks.
It turns out what makes a beak is actually a pretty identifiable gene. And by blocking how that gene was expressed in the facial development of a chicken embryo, Arkat and his colleagues were able to produce a chicken embryo that developed a snout instead of a beak, exactly as the morphospace predicted.
The morphospace predicted that this gap will be filled, that these shapes are possible. By gradually changing the amount of FGFA in the middle of the face, we're able to gradually transform the face back into its more ancestral condition.
Lots of other researchers are looking at wings, tails, feathers, etc., to understand how each characteristic is controlled by genes. The combination of all this knowledge is like unlocking the source code for DNA. Eventually, we might be able to map how the wildly complex set of instructions in DNA results in the amazingly sophisticated biology that is all around us. Chances are, unless there's an eccentric billionaire out there with a spare island to dedicate to it, we're not going to be turning chickens back into T-Rexes anytime soon.
Yes.
But in the short term, this research will contribute to practical applications, like genetic engineering for better livestock. And it could also help treat human developmental disorders. The DNA that built dinosaurs and megalodons and all the other crazy things we see in our past, it's still here, preserved and passed down by the very process of life itself. Thanks for watching. I hope you liked this video. Please follow us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram so that we can continue to share stories about people thinking differently and changing the world.